Good evening. Good evening. On behalf of the director, Susan Weber, it's my pleasure to welcome all of you here tonight to the Bard Graduate Center, all of you here in this room, and those of you watching through our live stream around the world. Slim, but intellectually powerful. All of us in the room would love to be described that way. That's how the Bard Graduate Center was described by the New York Times a few years ago. And tonight, we're celebrating some of that power. We're celebrating a book in particular, and we're celebrating two projects. Cultural Histories of the Material World, the series in which ways of making and knowing appears, began in 2009 as an idea, as part of a collaboration between the Bard Graduate Center and Harvard University Press, and in particular, Daniel Lee, who I'd like to ask to stand up now. Dan has now migrated upwards from Harvard and is our director of publishing here. And the book series, the idea of the book series, represents our own commitment to doing cultural history from and with and through objects across a broad disciplinary arc from art history through history, archaeology, and anthropology, and on to technology. The first three books in this series surveyed the state of the question, study the history of doing history from objects comparatively, looking at early modern Europe and China, looked at the impact of one particular kind of material, water, on historiography. And upcoming books in the series turn towards the new vistas from anthropology as they open up. Aaron Hazanoff's collection as number 5, Anthropology of Expeditions, to be published later this spring, and number 6, Itai Weinrib's volume on ex voto objects, to be published in the fall. Future titles will include a translation of Carl Schlegel's In Space We Read Time, Ben Kafka and Lisa Gittleman's Paper Trail, and an edition of the selected works of André Leroy-Gourhant, all of those to be published in 2016. But tonight we're here to celebrate number 4, Ways of Making and Knowing, a vision of science emerging out of the empirical encounter with the material world. With this book, about which we will hear, of course, much more tonight, material culture takes us into forgotten lives and forgotten or never before noticed topologies of knowledge. That's one thing we're celebrating. But the second thing that we're celebrating is a project in which ways of making and knowing itself nests like a Venn diagram. In 2010, in Berlin, Horst Bredekamp and the members of the Technische Bild group talked with us about a possible collaboration, looking at the way in which technical imagery and the kinds of objects technical images refer to constitutes a domain of the material that had not hitherto been studied. The project, as it evolved, emerged with a visiting professor, a member of the Tech Build group, coming to New York, to the Bard Graduate Center in 2011 and 12, and then an exhibition curated by that visiting professor in the fall of 2012. And there's the catalog of it here. It's actually, I cheated a little bit, it's actually this catalog, which was the slim and intellectually powerful object of the New York Times' praise. But as part of that collaboration with Berlin, we also, at the Bard Graduate Center, undertook to do a translation of the volume produced by that group in 2008 and published by Akademie Verlag in Berlin. And it's a great pleasure for me to wave this volume. We have only two copies straight off of the airplane from Germany where it was printed. The Technical Image, A History of Styles and Scientific Imagery, co-published by the Bard Graduate Center and the University of Chicago Press. So it's a very big celebration. I would say, in addition to Dan, who has masterminded all of these, I'd like to acknowledge through our live stream Laura Gray, who was the art director here, who designed all of these books and who is now a professor of graphic design at Boston University. Laura, thank you very much. And now to tonight's celebration of Volume 4. We have an elaborate program, which will kick off very soon with the three editors speaking. I'd just like to introduce them, and then I will pass the baton over to one of them to direct us through the program. The three editors of the volume, Harold Cook, Pamela Smith, and Amy Meyers. Hal Cook has taught and held challenging administrative positions at Harvard, the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and the Wellcome Trust Center for the History of Medicine at University College London, and is now in the Department of History at Brown University. His area of research is early modern Europe, in particular England and the Netherlands. He's known, I think, to many of us here for his prize-winning book, Matters of Exchange, Commerce, Medicine, and Science in the Dutch Golden Age, published by Yale in 2007. More recently, works of his include editing with Timothy Walker a special issue on the circulation of medicine in the early modern Atlantic world for Social History of Medicine, 2013, and with Sven Dupre translating knowledge in the early modern Low Countries, also 2013, and with Lawrence Monet, Golden Movements, Local Concerns, Medicine and Health in Southeast Asia, 2012. And Hal will be coming in here on the screen later this evening. Pamela Smith is the founding director of the Columbia Center for Science and Society and Seth Lowe Professor of History at Columbia University. She's the author of The Business of Alchemy, Science and Culture in the Holy Roman Empire, published in 1994, which won the 1995 Pfizer Prize for the best book in the history of science from the History of Science Society, and The Body of the Artisan, Art and Experience in the Scientific Revolution, 2004, which won the 2005 Leo Gershoy Prize of the American Historical Association for the best book in European history. Co-edited volumes include Merchants and Marvels, Commerce, Science, and Art in Early Modern Europe, 2002, Making Knowledge in Early Modern Europe, Practices, Objects, and Texts, 1400 to 1800, that's 2008. The Matter of Art, Materials, Technologies, Meanings, circa 1250-1650, which will be published this year, 2015. She's won many, many fellowships, Guggenheim, Getty Scholar, Kress Fellow, Fellow at the Wissenschaftskolleg zu Berlin, and at COSVA in Washington. Fellowships also from the National Endowment for the Humanities, Andrew Mellon Foundation, National Science Foundation. And she's now working on, as many of you know, a critical edition of a 16th century craft manuscript that will be published as an open access digital volume around which her teaching is being built at Columbia. Amy Meyers is the director of the Yale Center for British Art, where she's been since 2002. Prior to her appointment, she's been at Dumbarton Oaks, COSVA at the National Gallery, and the Huntington Library in California. She is the author, editor of Knowing Nature, Art and Science in Philadelphia, 1740 to 1840, that's 2012, with Therese O'Malley, editor, The Art of Natural History, Illustrated Treatises and Botanical Paintings, 1400 to 1850, 2008, an editor of Art and Science in America, Issues of Representation, 1998, and co-editor of Empire's Nature, Mark Catesby's New World Vision, published in 1998. And in her day job, she has been instrumental in expanding the Yale Center for British Arts Fellowship Program, initiated the cataloging of collections online, and supported the creation of a conservation plan for the institution's landmark building. It's a pleasure to welcome Amy Meyers to begin tonight's program. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter, and welcome, ladies and gentlemen. As Peter has indicated, the book of splendid essays that we launched this evening at the kind invitation of the Bard Graduate Center had its genesis in an extraordinary conference. The experience of that gathering can only begin to be conjured by this elegant volume. Maybe a little fatter than slim, but I hope equally elegant. And in fact, the event would be difficult to evoke in any tangible way, given the range of complex and fascinating sites we explored, the diverse number of fine papers we heard, the numerous breakout sessions in which we engaged in the examination of objects of a remarkable kind, and the instructive demonstrations in which we participated. We thought, however, that we should try to give you at least a sense of the proceedings before we enter into our discussion of the many new and stimulating ways in which the associated concepts of making and knowing are being interrogated today within a variety of spheres ranging from the studio, workshop, and laboratory to the museum, classroom, and research institute. In July of 2005, the Wellcome Trust Center for the History of Medicine at University College London, the Yale Center for British Art, and the Paul Mellon Center for Studies in British Art hosted a five-day conference in London and its environs entitled Ways of Making and Knowing, the Material Culture of Empirical Knowledge, the title, of course, of the fine volume that we launched tonight. The conference, which received funding from the National Science Foundation, originated from a series of conversations in which Pamela Smith, Hal Cook, and I had been engaged for many years concerning ways in which knowledge of the natural world had been and could be wrought from the processes of making. Our research had led us each to the rich collections of London's broad spectrum of repositories, its museums, libraries, and archives, scientific cabinets, and botanical gardens, and over the years had acquainted us with communities of scholars working within these institutions directly with the objects for which they were responsible, as well as with those from the Academy and other collections who regularly engaged in research on these holdings from varying points of view. Given Pamela's work on the reconstitution of historical practices of making related to the production of knowledge, she also had come to know a group of artisans and, in fact, artists who shared our common interest, and we determined that an event at which these artisans and scholars could be brought together with, in the specific fields, historians of science and medicine, art historians, garden historians, literary historians, and museum scholars, sometimes focused on these areas, at other times focused in other directions, to share their work would yield an important index of the field and might galvanize new research partnerships, taking the study in innovative directions. Thus, at the end of a beautiful summer's day, we first gathered our speakers and participants at the Chelsea Physic Garden simply to walk the paths among the beds laid out by the apothecary's company and to begin an informal conversation. We then moved to the British Museum for an introduction to the project of the Enlightenment Galleries and an exploration of the objects therein. We next proceeded to the Royal Botanical Gardens at Kew for a series of papers and breakout sessions examining not only the garden itself, but the pagoda and the palace. And the subsequent day found us at the Natural History Museum following a similar pattern of papers and breakout sessions in the collections. We followed that with an evening at the Linnaean Society for discussion of their collections and a talk on Linnaeus himself, and then proceeded the next day to the V&A, again dividing our time between formal papers and examinations of parts of the collections, including a demonstration of glass blowing. The final day took us to Painsill Park for an exploration of the restored 18th century landscape with a particular focus on the conserved beds of the first so-called American garden in Britain and an examination of a didactic garden explicating period methods of planting, collecting, and gardening. We also were able to engage in various practices of making that day, including hazel wattle hurdle, the weaving of wooden frames and fences, brick throwing, vine training, and other means of production associated with garden culture of the period. The cumulative layered intellectual and physical experience that we shared over the course of 5 days with extraordinary colleagues was much too rich and multifarious to be captured in a single production. But the splendid essays that were developed from a selection of the papers and breakout sessions are testament to the fine work that has resulted in myriad spheres from this intensive examination of the processes of making and knowing. We hope that you will find the book illuminating and the discussion in which we will engage this evening suggestive of exciting ways forward along the valuable avenue of inquiry that interests us all. Thank you, and thank you to the Bard.
But the splendid essays that were developed from
And if anybody says anything that I really want to reply to, I'll get a chance to do that by clicking my microphone at this end and interrupting. Otherwise, I'm just going to listen. But I just wanted to say thanks to all of you, especially to Pamela and Amy, of course, and to the Bard Center. I also want to just acknowledge the work of colleagues in the former center, especially Alan Scheele, who is our administrator, Sally Bragg, who did a lot of the arranging of personal visits, and Sharon Messenger, who organized a lot of the activities around the conference. In those days, I was heading a center that was trying to make things happen in the field of the history of medicine. And when Pamela and I, and then Amy and Pamela and I, began to have discussions about a conference of this kind, I was very enthusiastic, and I was very happy that we could do a lot of the supporting effort from the London side. Just briefly, for me, there were three very interesting issues at stake here. One was to help to reconnect a number of institutions in London that had once grown from the same sources, but over the years had become distinct and had been given missions that were slightly different, and that people in the different institutions weren't necessarily coordinating their activities or talking to one another about a past when they had all been together. So for me, reconnecting the institutions in London was an important objective. A second was to bring practice back into the field of the history of medicine. You would think that the art and science of medicine go together, and that practice, medical practice, would be very much a part of the conversation in the history of medicine, but I had the opinion at the time that the history of medicine had grown too close to the history of science and to a kind of post-Foucauldian moment in which lots of things were involved with culture and ideas and not enough with material culture and the doing of things. So I saw this as an opportunity to reconnect history of medicine to other conversations people were having about practices. And finally, for me, I also wanted to use this as an opportunity. I know Pamela and Amy were very enthusiastic about this too, but when I was learning about the history of medicine in Europe and Britain, I ended up relying a lot on curators and librarians and other people with enormous expertise who taught me so much about the history of medicine and science and other fields. And unfortunately, those kind of people are often left out of our academic conversations. And even because of the way that they go about their business, we go about our business, they got left out of our book to an extent that I know that Pamela and Amy are missing too, just because they were such an important part of this conference. So I wanted to really bring our conversations of an academic kind back to being more inclusive in terms of drawing on, putting a face to the kinds of people that we're often in conversation with and that really need to be acknowledged publicly. It is a very important part of the world that we live in and have contributed so much to all of us. So those were my agendas, and I was delighted with the outcome, and I think that's all I have to say. I'm going to click my microphone off now and just listen in, and I'll click back in if there's anything I really want to say in the rest of the conversation. Thanks.
Well, first I want to, of course, thank Peter Miller and Daniel Lee and the Bard Graduate Center. And it's really thrilling to all of us, Amy, Hal, and I hope our 70-plus participants in that conference, some of whom are watching the live stream, I know, and also to see this really fantastical conference that Amy described having this long afterlife. So our celebration tonight is partly about celebrating the publication of this beautiful purple volume, Ways of Making and Knowing, in what I think is really a path-breaking BGC series, Cultural Histories of the Material World. And certainly the 70-plus contributors to the conference, as well as the authors who contributed such stimulating articles to the volume, deserve this celebration. And I'm never one to pass up a celebration, but I have to admit that I can only see this volume as a kind of failure. Not in its content, as I think the articles in the book do convey our overarching aim, which was to show that making and knowing are not just related to each other or part of a cumulative knowledge-making process, but that making both constitutes and is constitutive of knowing. We wanted to break down especially the historiographical barriers between craft, skill, and scientific knowing. Nor do I think the production values make this book a failure by any means. It's really, Bard Graduate Center and the University of Michigan did a beautiful job. It has full color photos, which we are very happy about. But rather, I see it as a failure in its inability to convey the multidisciplinary and the collaborative sparks that flew in our sessions around objects and making processes. As Amy described, the conference included 5 very full days divided between formal lectures and object-based sessions around fascinating specimens from multiple London museums, which were brought together sometimes in people's handbag. There was a gilded silver cast from live frog that was brought from the Royal Collections to the V&A in a handbag through the London subway. So all of these specimens and all of these people came together, and we gathered around these objects, multidisciplinary historians of science, medicine, academic, and museum scholars, and we had intense conversations, exciting conversations. And unfortunately, we found that little of that could be conveyed by this, I was going to say modest, but now I'll say slim purple object that we have here tonight, except you will find, if you look carefully at the acknowledgments and you look carefully at the Bard Graduate Center website, you'll see that the glassmaker, Ian Hanke, who was involved in a session on 16th century Venetian glass at the RCA with the glass curator from the V&A, Rhino Leafcase, that during that He actually produced a wonderful Renaissance Venetian glassmaking video, wonderful video, and it's hidden away in the BGC website. So I urge you to look for that as just a little taste of what this conference was like. But so if this book is in some ways a failure, I found that like all disasters in artisanal making, I learned more from this failure than I would have from self-satisfied success. What I learned is that a book is just not an optimal means of conveying ways of making and knowing, or of conveying object-based, real-time, exciting conversations. And that's why my present foray into making and knowing, the Making and Knowing Project, is a multimedia extravaganza involving a cast of, by now, truly hundreds. But I want to introduce 3 of the most important co-collaborators and co-teachers in this tonight who are here, who are Donna Bilak, and who is waving back there, and Jenny Boubelet, and Joel Klein. And I'm very glad that they could be here. We spend many, many hours a day together. We are bonded for life, I think. But what this project is a critical edition, or what it will be, is what we're doing, is producing a critical edition and English translation of a really fascinating 16th century compilation of technical recipes that's held by the Bibliothèque Nationale. It gives insight into objects, technical recipes, and procedures for Kunstkammer-like objects, portrait metals, life casts, imitation coral, but also a wealth of other things. But it's also a wonderful insight, gives wonderful insight into and really unique information into the practices of daily life and into the early modern workshop. But it's also a testament, its actual written form and its being preserved is a testament to the deep interest in making practices in the 16th and 17th centuries. But I think that, you know, that's the product, a critical edition. But the really interesting part of the project, I think, is actually the process by which we're getting there, which we hope will be there by 2019. And this will be a digital critical edition of the manuscript by a series of really what we're calling expert crowdsourcing workshops and courses. And it involves, first of all, a paleography workshop every summer for 3 summers. Last year was the first one in which we worked on mold making and metalworking recipes. And the students of French who learned paleography and then practiced it on this manuscript transcribed and translated about a third of the manuscript. This year, we're going to be working on color making recipes in the manuscript. The call for applications is still open until February 24th, so please apply. Then this transcription and translation forms the basis for a series of laboratory seminars which began last September and are continuing every semester. And in this, the students conduct historical text-based and hands-on laboratory-based research on the recipes. And this laboratory research focuses on attempting to understand materials and processes appearing in the manuscript by a variety of techniques, including reconstruction, but also by a lot of very standard historical research in recipes. The student research is brought together at the end of each semester in multimedia essays that will form the historical and material annotations for the critical edition of the manuscript. And then at the end of each year, we'll have a working group meeting that will bring together scholars, practitioners, and all of the students from both classes in order to discuss and critique the annotations and to bring together more scholars and more information about the manuscript. So I am thrilled to expose my graduate students to hands-on work and to this valuable, which is a valuable source of historical evidence in art historical and history of science research. And that's really, I think, the future that I see of making, or one of the futures of making and knowing, that I see as very fruitful for producing further research in this area. And I will be very eager to hear the ideas of our panelists, who we will turn to now. So I will introduce them very briefly. Our first speaker panelist will be Ned Cook, who is the Charles F. Montgomery Professor of American Decorative Arts in the Department of History of Art at Yale. He has focused for a long time and is an expert on American material culture, domestic architecture, and the decorative arts. He has published extensively on furniture and wood in particular, his Making Furniture in Pre-Industrial America, The Social Economy of Newtown and Woodbury, Connecticut, explores the artisanal world of colonial and early national America. He is the co-curator and publication author of 5 exhibitions, including New American Furniture, Inspiring Reform, Boston's Arts and Crafts Movement, Wood Turning in North America since 1930, and The Maker's Hand, American Studio Furniture, from 1940 to 1990. He is also the co-founding editor of the Journal of Modern Craft. I am going to introduce all of our speakers together. Florence Grant will be our second speaker, is a postdoctoral research associate at Yale at the Yale Center for British Art, where she contributes to exhibition projects focused on the intersections between the arts and the sciences, especially in the 18th century. She is part of the team working on the upcoming exhibition, Enlightened Princesses, Caroline, Augusta, Charlotte, and the Shaping of the Modern World. This will be a very interesting exhibition which examines royal women's patronage and collecting at the British court between 1714 and 1818. And I know that the argument of this exhibition is that these women were making knowledge, making natural knowledge in both their patronage but also in their collection and their replication and representation of all of these natural objects. Florence is also working with Amy Meyers on an exhibition showcasing the work and world of the American artist naturalist William Bartram. And Florence's most recent article, Scientific Experiment as Moral Exercise in the Education of George III, appeared in the British Journal for the History of Science last year. Finally, Glenn Adamson will join us. Glenn, at 6:15 sharp, just-in-time delivery of our speakers. Glenn Adamson joined the Museum of Arts and Design as director in October 2013. He had previously served as head of the research department at the Victoria and Albert Museum in London, and where he curated exhibitions such as the major survey, Postmodernism, Style and Subversion, 1970 to 1990 in 2011, and the forthcoming, The Future, A History, which will premiere in 2017. He has had widespread influence on makers as well as craft historians and theorists, and he's published several books, including The Invention of Craft, The Craft Reader, Thinking Through Craft, and he, with Ned Cook, is co-founding co-editor of the Journal of Modern Craft. So I want to ask you to welcome our panelists, and I look forward to what you're going to tell us about the future of making and knowing.
Thanks so much, Pamela. So I guess I am now the slim version up here, and see what I can do in terms of intellectual ambition or whether I go back to modesty. But sort of this linking of making and knowing has been one of these projects that has been on my mind for quite some time. So I thought I needed to do a little bit of not just simply the future, where we need to go, but a little bit of historiography, because in some ways, in my mind, making is central to both knowledge and meaning. And how can we really understand something without knowing something about its production, how it came into existence? And it's been this kind of interest of mine to move from just through my education of this sort of frustration with the aesthetics as sort of a formal issue in and of its own right without any understanding of choices that went into something. And it started, you know, when I was at Winterthur and people started describing how they steam bent mahogany to make Bombay furniture, and I just thought, this is wrong. You can see the tangential face of the wood and see the pattern and know that it was actually hacked out of a solid 4-inch thick piece of mahogany, and that there was a lot of waste on the floor that no one was ever going to be talking about. And I started reading in a very different way. And I remember in particular reading Bob St. George's article about Dedham chess and this whole notion that everyone was interested in David Pye, workmanship of risk and certainty, and this layout for these scroll patterns that you see in the upper right, and making this whole big thing about workmanship of certainty and using of a compass and how they would then use a compass to lay out all these lines in between. And it's one of these things that just sort of, in my mind, said, this is over-theorizing something. This is applying something that didn't quite make sense. And when I had the chance, while writing a dissertation, to have a free course in the program in artisanry at BU, something you always think of when writing a dissertation, right? Free course. But I had questions I wanted to ask of the material. There were things that I was taught that people told me that I just thought made no sense whatsoever. So I wanted to start asking questions of material, not simply getting into the archive, not simply doing field work. And so I enrolled in this class because I taught some of these students in the program in artisanry on woodworking. You know, I'm writing a chapter on the world of the joiner in the 18th century, and I had things I wanted to figure out. So first project was a subtractive technology, carving in essence. And you got to remember, I had a father with three left thumbs, no sort of background in this stuff. And I thought, okay, here's my chance to actually look at these panels. I'm going to see if I can carve one of these. And so I went over to the MFA and I looked at the original one. And then I sort of drew it, I had a picture, and I went back, and all of a sudden there was this moment. The aha moment was, it wasn't so much taking a compass and doing all those fine lines in between. What I realized is, if I had four tools, I could carve the entire thing. And I carved it in 20 minutes, having never done something like this, and realized it's the radius of the gouge that determines everything as you go through there, as well as a straight line. So you can use a compass just to do the tops and bottoms, but everything else is determined by your choice of tools. Kind of a revelation of thinking, okay, so it is right about workmanship of certainty, but the workmanship of certainty is still held by the human hand, and it's the actual tool rather than this kind of jig for laying it out, sort of what we tend to think of as the fun woodworking approach now. So it started me on these whole series of questions. I was just kept making projects. You know, I was working on some carved feet and wanted to sort of understand what carved feet, how you would go about carving a foot, and realized these so-called sort of Spanish feet weren't retarded terror. It was merely a mid-level kind of foot. You could get a lot of bang for your buck because it was a lot easier than carving a ball and claw foot, which these same shops would do as well. So it's just, it's an option. It's an economic option. I remember people telling me about miter dovetails and Germanic construction, the obsessive annual compulsion of German cabinet makers. And, you know, also I could think, and the way it was talked about was this incredibly fastidious way of mitering the dovetail all the way through. Then I made them, I realized also it is, it's a simple cut along the top surface of that actual joint, that it's no different once you get down below that the appearance that you see along the top part. So to me, these were just sort of projects as the world of the 18th century joiner, which had been available to me only in inventories, in some sort of sense of tools, and looking at tool marks, all of a sudden came alive in a very different way. And it's something that continued to inform the way in which I approach my work. I was asked to write a series of essays on wood turning, and then ultimately getting into the wood turning catalog. And I thought, how can I write about this if I've never even tried it? And so I talked to Albert Lakoff, who was the director of the Wood Turning Center, and said, would you have a scholar in residence come down and work with the people who are coming from Australia, France, and various other places to come and work with you for a week? And he said, sure, why not? And I said, okay, give me 2 days to work, to be taught some of the basics with Palmer Sharpless, this guy who taught shop at the George School, learn how to do faceplate turning, spindle turning, and then I spent a day with each of those turners. With Jean-Francois Esculin, his English was not so good, my French was not so good, but it was amazing in terms of how we'd get on a lathe together, he'd show me something, I would do it on a lathe next to him, and it was just this sort of call and response, you know, learning how to use a bedan, which is a different kind of turning tool that a French turner has. And so I made an object with each of these turners, you know, in the course of a day, working sort of within their own idiom. And to me, you know, what became obvious, you just look at the selection of things that I'm making, you know, a covered cup, a sculptural piece of, you know, sort of a pyramid piercing a globe, and then a green turned bowl. You know, what I got was the sense that a lathe, which in many people is sort of the evil part of the industrial empire, is merely another tool that has many different applications. You can't a lathe does not predetermine a result, is one of these takeaway features. And it, you know, that notion about our preconceived ideas about a lot of materials, about trying to put yourself on the shop floor, as it were, started to inform whenever I'd go into somebody's shop. You know, I went to an open studio and a glass blower's said, oh, can I blow? And he's got, sure, why not? And what you end up doing is sort of understanding something about the body. And Pamela, going back to sort of think about the body of the artisan, I'd never realized, you know, nowadays when people do glass demos, they have rock and roll music playing and, you know, sort of this big sense of what's going on that seems like, as I said, it's a rock show. But actually, there's a lot about dancing and the body as you try to keep this glob of glass from sagging at the end of your blowpipe. As you move from the furnace, blowing, trying to get the air and make it symmetrical onto the marver's bench to try to move it and to create its shape yet again, you're constantly in motion, paying attention to not dropping the glob onto the floor. And, you know, block printing, even with aniline dyes, you know, you're not sort of engaged in vegetable dyes, but just knowing something about the sound that you hear in block printing in Rajasthan of that constant thump-boom, 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 as they're going down the large table with the cotton spread out. Seeing how you can register these objects by eye, how you line it up. These are things that just really help you understand, and it sort of gets ingrained into your body. So you start to put sound, body motion, it's not simply a visual sort of endeavor, which I think the world of slides of formal analysis oftentimes privileges the eye over any other sense. Actually, people who do vegetable dyes talk about tongue and tasting. You can taste the mordants, different kinds of mordants. You know, these are things that one can't learn oftentimes through book. I mean, this is the kind of thing that someone needs to lead you through it. I try to then think about how do you transform this into the classroom? And you know, there's such a thing that I might refer to as static teaching. That's fixed point in time. And how do I compensate for it so it doesn't become mere connoisseurship, which is sort of the way in which some of this information has been brought about in the past. One of the things that I've been doing is trying to think about a global material culture class in which, you know, if I'm talking about ceramic history, I'm not just doing earthenware, stoneware, and porcelain, but I put fritware in there, which most of the time is never discussed in standard accounts, to try to do cross-cultural comparative study that gives them that kind of awareness maybe of what else might have been possible, because ultimately that's what I think I'm really trying to get at now in terms of the teaching and moving forward, is the sense that you're not just looking at fixed sort of entities, but you're thinking about possibilities. What were the choices? What's the selection that goes into something? And just again, sort of thinking about static, and I was thinking, you know, with Pamela here, of thinking about casting in brass, and working in brass, and how you could even talk about ways in which sort of these guidebooks, these wonderful Kashmiri book that's at the British Library that has scenes of these South Asian makers and then some of the tools of their trade, including, you know, a push-pull lathe to finish something in the lower right, the Maltese that is for casting, having clay crucibles in which the brass actually melts and flows right into the cavity, or sometimes even in terms of the wax of some of the other traditions, pushing that out. That, you know, this incredible way of sort of internal crucibles is really quite fascinating. Raising brass implements, you know, with raising hammer stakes on it set in the ground. To look at somebody producing kalshis in West Bengal, you know, again, this is the kind of field work. You go out and you start asking questions, observing and seeing what's going on in terms of what I always refer to as low technology, but does not necessarily mean sort of poorly skilled. This is high tacit knowledge that goes into, if you watch these people separate out their scrap metal into different piles to produce the kind of alloy composition they want, to watch them hammer these pieces up from basically molten pieces that are melted in a crucible, poured into sort of an open dish to make these mulchy, you know, unleavened bread loaves, it looks like, and then hammering them out into sheets and up into forms, in this case making these necked kalshis, which then get hammered out, filed, and then turned on a lathe to produce the final object. And again, you start to thinking about the number of, the amount of labor that goes into this, you know, sort of seeing from start of the melting of the alloy into the final product. It's very intensive. It requires a lot of that hand-eye skill, muscle memory that we talk about in terms of the artisanal background. Even how the British educators tried to sort of capture some of this and had the ceramists make models of these different kinds of trades to see the kinds of equipment that's being used for chasing and repoussé chasing, the different kinds of vessels, the importance of chasing as a finished decoration, or how there might be different systems of production. What happens if you go to Morocco where they just have industrial produced sheet brass? They don't have to worry about melting scrap metal. They just take the sheet metal, lay it out with a compass, start beating it up into a trunk, into a dish shape, and then raising it over a hammer, and then maybe chasing the kind of decorative design in that you see in the upper right. A whole different kind of commodity chain that they're relying simply on sheet brass. And they're selling this predominantly to tourists and other people coming through the souks at that point. And then how different that might be from taking sheet brass and spinning it on a lathe. These are all choices. These are all possibilities. This is different ways of getting a brass vessel that can contain liquids. You have different choices. There's different investment in terms of capital, in terms of skill that's required, and how that fits into these different kinds of economies. So again, you know, what I tried to do within the static imagery of capturing images, videos, is to try to convey a sense of the depth of tacit knowledge or these kinds of commodity chains that might be possible. I have been able to do more experiential kind of learning, collaborating with Peter Follinsby, who was the joiner at Plymouth Plantation, somebody I've known and have a working relationship for a number of years. And I was teaching a freshman seminar on furniture and American life in the furniture study collection of the Yale Art Gallery. And I spend the first part sort of talking about woods and wood properties and working green wood, et cetera. And brought Peter down. This is a class that's an hour and 15 minutes. 9 o'clock in the morning, not necessarily always 17-year-old's best time of the day. But what was fascinating was I said to Peter, okay, you know, obviously we can't make a full thing, but we can rive wood, we can plane it, and we can learn how to carve some of it. And watching these students initially sort of shy with a fro to split out wood, they were initially tentative, and then all of a sudden, you know, it's like, clicked on, and these students just started to get into it. They started splitting wood, and then, you know, I had two football players in this class who trying to plane wood, and watching them use a plane like a almost like a jet landing on an aircraft carrier. They come down and whomp, and you know, try to muscle it. And I was saying, no, it's all that body, it's all that lean. And he said, establish it, and he just lean forward with it. And then these football players just keep grunting and trying to do it. And then one of these smaller women in it gets up and just goes zzz, and has a perfect shaving. She listened in terms of how you can just rock through in terms of planing. What was striking is that these students, actually half of them stayed on well through and missed classes that were coming up next because they got into it and took. Literally, they took shavings with themselves, they took samples of what they carved. There was something very tangible that they got from that particular class. And so this just sort of conveys a sense of it. So ultimately, what I thought is to summarize what it is I'm really talking about. One is sort of the traditional way in which people had talked about construction details and diagnostic traits and looking at an old object or a new object. And what I refer to sort of as a narrowing inward focus of object-centered study, that you're really sort of boring down deep into the fine grain. And it's that sense that construction sort of is a fait accompli, it's a stable end unto itself. And that you can take all these different kinds of bits of information, and I'm using the little carrot there because what it does is it sort of just narrows down to a single identification or attribution. It's this kind of taking a lot of different information and just like getting one little kernel as a result. And what I think is a more promising way to think about sort of making, knowing, meaning is to think about this expanding outward, a consideration of object driven, that is, take the object and then where does it take you? So that is considering what you see, what you can evaluate within that existing evidence as one of several possibilities or solutions. There's no presumption here. You've got to be sort of more open-minded. And so if you look at those series of diagnostic features, rather than narrowing down, it opens out to understanding choice, to understanding, as I sometimes have referred to in my work in the 18th century, as social economy. How does it fit into this larger sort of context? This is the kind of evidence that we really need to get at.
So how do we get at teaching material literacy? And it's something that you'll hear about a little bit with Florence as well. But you know, it seems like there are a couple different criteria and why it's going to be difficult making the shift and why Pamela's work is so exciting to go from static teaching awareness into experiential kinds of teaching. Because space, it requires a dedicated space. It's not your normal classroom. It's messy. It needs maybe fuel sources. It needs all sorts of different kinds of elements to it, some of which might be even expensive. So it's not simply, and you know, this is not a place for demos. I sometimes find that, you know, just somebody doing a demo and saying, okay, now you understand it, right? And it's sort of like, if you haven't tried it, there's a huge leap between a demo and then trying it yourself. Videos, again, these are things that are helpful only sort of as a backup, in essence, to that kind of experiential that you've had yourself. Materials, equipment, tools. I find even with an art school, even with an architectural workshop in the basement of my building, it's difficult to secure this kind of operation to teach safely. You know, in terms of, you've got hot materials, you've got sharp tools, you've got danger of distractions, people who are being pulled in lots of different directions as undergraduates, graduates, you have a better chance for that kind of stability. But still, you know, there's a lot of risk involved in this kind of teaching. That, you know, it's why they actually, in teaching wood turning over the course of the 20th century, they went from learning how to cut to then just teaching how to scrape wood, because there were going to be less chance of people hurting themselves or killing themselves on a lathe. I think that ultimately, you know, it's impossible to be a maker and an academic scholar. In some respects, it's a partnership. It's a collaborative sort of thing. And I don't know quite what the right ratio. I mean, I just put 60-40 up there because one automatically thinks in this kind of weather of a 60-40 jacket, right? But I wonder whether it's 70-30. Because here's part, you know, here I've worked with Peter Follansbee, who's written articles with his deep analysis of 17th century joinery and does documentary evidence as well. So it's that kind of interchange. And then finally, time. And I know I'm near the end of my time. Time, what can you accomplish in class time and with a variety of skills? And it becomes that need for a collaboration to sort of think about what can we do within a two-hour class, a three-hour class that can become meaningful, that can give these people some sort of access to it all, and appeal and to tell them all about these different senses, to think about body in motion, to think about sound, smell, touch, rhythm. I mean, it's all these things that are so essential to shop floor learning. And it's not the typical way of learning. So it's the kind of thing, I think it's a challenge for us to work on. I should turn it over to Florence now. Thank you.
Super. So as you've just heard, I'm working with Ned, developing some of the interests and ideas he's just been telling us about, and looking for ways to integrate practice-based perspectives on making and materials into teaching for art history graduate students at Yale. These plans are so far in the future of making and knowing that I don't have any pictures to show you. I'm sorry. But the project really comes out of the concern that because students in art history don't generally have an opportunity to experience the material processes implicit in the objects they study, their analytical resources can be correspondingly limited. As Ned was saying, the dynamic qualities of materials can get erased in interpretation if we aren't primed to recognize their traces. And the problem with this, I know I'm preaching to the choir, is that the social, cultural, and economic significance of works of art and other artifacts rests as much with the dynamics of their materials as it does with the play of form and iconography. So we're calling the kind of competency we're aiming to foster material literacy. And this will mean introducing students to the studio, lab, and workshop practices of conservators, scientists, and makers through hands-on exercises, as well as developing a robust conceptual framework, connecting these activities with more familiar forms of teaching and research. In doing so, we hope to foster good habits of analysis, the application of a more diverse range of research practices, and reflection on how these resources can generate new kinds of questions for historians. At the moment, we're focusing on processes of production relating to sculpture and objects of material culture, rather than painting, despite the obvious importance of painting for art historians. The reason for this, from my perspective at least, is that for painting, there already is a developed infrastructure connecting studio practice, conservation, technical analysis, and historical research. Our priority so far has been thinking about how something comparable could be put together for a wider range of types of objects. We've also been concentrating on the kinds of connections we most lack. And at this point, they seem to be those with contemporary makers and practices. And what I say this evening sort of reflects that state of our thinking. So one of the most exciting things about this project is its potential for setting up deep and long-lasting collaborations across disciplines and institutions. And we're extremely fortunate to have colleagues at Yale in conservation and conservation science, based not only at the Center for British Art, but at the University Art Gallery and the Institution for the Preservation of Cultural Heritage. And many of them are already involved with teaching in different forms. Their expertise will be central to the success of our project. But to develop a workable set of exercises and demonstrations and the infrastructure that this implies, we'll also need the help of makers of all kinds, from those who view themselves as working within established craft traditions to others running computer-controlled milling machines and 3D printers. I'm sure that I don't need to tell everyone here about the kinds of circular logic that go into setting up a workshop of the kind that we'll need. Choices about space and equipment are pretty much directly shaped by what you think you want to do and how you want to do it. But if you don't have a way of trying things out, those decisions get a lot harder to make. And so we've come up with two ways of short-circuiting that loop. One is that we're planning a week-long masterclass at the Penland School of Crafts in Western North Carolina in January 2016. And in the meantime, we're making connections with existing workshops at Yale with an eye to developing some short sort of taster events for art history faculty. Working with the Penland School is appealing for a variety of reasons. They run all year round, combining short classes with longer sessions and residencies. They have well-equipped studios in textiles, ceramics, glass, metals, printmaking, woodworking, books and paper, and photography. And they host a constantly changing series of instructors drawn from a network of highly skilled makers and dedicated teachers. And all this will give us the opportunity to learn from their studio coordinators and their administrators, but also to tap into the school's social network as we develop the physical infrastructure and the personal and professional connections that we'll depend on later on. The masterclass will be arranged around the theme of heat, plasticity, and fusibility. And we'll move from the iron studio for looking at forging and welding into small metals to think about casting, and then glass blowing. And the ways in which heat transforms materials under the blacksmith's hammer or in the furnace can be spectacular, but I think what's good about heat from a conceptual standpoint is that it connects the history of art and material culture directly with social and economic history and the histories of the environment and technology. Thinking specifically about shifts between charcoal, coal, and gas as sources of heat, those changes are registered in the workshop, but they are also representative of pretty massive changes on a much larger scale. So we have a lot to look forward to. In the meantime, we're looking at resources closer to home. Ned is visiting the woodworking shop in the School of Art and the facilities provided by the Center for Engineering, Innovation, and Design. And I've been spending some time in the chemistry department. It's really cool. Students in chemistry at Yale have the option to learn both machining and scientific glass blowing. And these classes are and workshops are open to members of the wider academic community. Their primary role is to enable people working in the sciences at Yale to make or have made for them specialized equipment for research. They function both as classrooms and as spaces of production. And we're hoping to hold one or more short events for art history faculty using these facilities as a way of building up energy around the project and making connections with potential collaborators at Yale. And for me, I've been spending some time in these workshops and participating in some of the classes that are held there. And that's really brought into focus an issue that I think will be with us for the entire project. And Ned pointed towards this at the end of his talk. And it's this problem that moving from our sort of home body of knowledge and practice into another makes us beginners all over again. And the relative simplicity of what we can accomplish in glass or metal correlates to our inexperience. So as we're thinking about how to design an interdisciplinary framework for this program, we shouldn't lose sight of the great sophistication in their own practices of the makers who are collaborating with us. And simply from the point of view of time management, the challenge is how, in a relatively short teaching session, to communicate the great depth and breadth of expert material knowledge while also providing direct experiences that are accessible to beginners. So that's where we've got to at the moment. And as we put these plans into practice, there are particular ways I'd like to develop our commitment to interdisciplinarity and collaboration. And there are also conversations that I would enjoy being part of about the conceptual and methodological implications of this and similar initiatives. And I'm sure that Pamela, over the course of the Making and Knowing project so far, you've addressed a lot of the things that I've been mulling over in relation to this project. So as I take it, a central implication of the phrase making and knowing is to call into question hierarchies of knowledge that have powerfully shaped the historiography of art and science. Projects like this present opportunities for breaking down such hierarchies as they function in the present within the disciplines that we ourselves practice through creative and willfully risk-taking collaborations and committed forms of interdisciplinarity. I'd like to take those opportunities for all they're worth and allow our conversations with makers and forays into studios and workshops to destabilize at least a little bit our sense of what historians know and how it is we come to that knowledge. Very broadly speaking, and this might be a little mischievous, historians are skilled at specialized forms of reading, writing, and talking. Those are the things at which, if we do poorly, we fail in the practice of our own discipline. For a sculptor or a jeweler or a painter, that short list of crucial skills is radically different. And as we develop forms of teaching that include studio, workshop, and lab practice, I think it will be vital to insist that the hybrid projects undertaken in this program be exposed to truly interdisciplinary criteria of success or failure. Put another way, I hope that the stakes of the making can be as high as the stakes of the writing. Within parameters appropriate to the level at which they are learning, it should be possible for participants in this program, if they've made something badly, to be told that's not good enough, to be shown why, to get the kinds of robust feedback that most challenge us to learn, and then do it over again, just as we would expect with the poorly written draft of a research paper. Otherwise, I think that we run the risk of recreating the hierarchies of knowledge that we seek to overturn. At the same time, all this raises questions about conceptual frameworks and the points of articulation between making and more established forms of historical research and writing. First, we talk about practical experience in the workshop or studio as a means for generating new kinds of historical questions. But are we also proposing this as a form of historical evidence? And if so, what kind of evidence is it? Second, following on from that, what would the implications of these novel forms of evidence be for familiar genres of writing and established forms of argumentation and citation, authority and review in history and art history? And I think the multimedia solution that you've found is a really elegant solution to that problem. Finally, I wonder about periodization and modern craft practice. On the one hand, relatively small-scale handwork seems well-suited to the kind of program Ned and I are developing, in part because of constraints of time and space, and in part because of the pre-existing structures for craft instruction that places like Penland can provide. But this surely limits the relevance of our workshop practice to the study of particular historical periods or cultural contexts. How might we approach, for example, 19th or 20th century manufacturing in a project like this? On the other hand, how should we construe the relationship between the crafts taught at Penland and the past practices we seek to understand as historians? Penland's iron studio has coal forges, plasma cutters, and everything in between. And we should see the full range of technologies, as well as the ideologies operating there, as fully of the present. Any sense of the past that we take from workshop or studio practice now will have to be explicitly framed and carefully negotiated. And these are really questions that I'm so pleased to be able to raise with this group in particular. And I'd love to hear from everyone how you think we might go about addressing them as we develop this project further.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Glenn Adamson. I'm the Nanette Leitman Director at the Museum of Arts and Design, and I cannot tell you what a pleasure it is to be here tonight with so many colleagues and friends in the room. And to say that this evening was long awaited is perhaps putting it slightly mildly. We actually started talking about this subject just before I started working at the Victoria and Albert Museum, my last job, which I believe was 2005, and here we are. The good thing about the delayed drop, as it were, of this project has been that it has lingered in the background of my thinking, and I think the background of the thinking of many people here in the room, as a kind of commonality or ground from which our intellectual interests could spring. And indeed, the phrase ways of making and knowing, which has been in my life since 2005, thanks to Pamela and her several colleagues, is about as good a phrase as I could choose to identify the exact core of my interests, first at the V&A, eventually as head of research at the V&A, and then more recently as director of the Museum of Arts and Design. So first, can I just ask for a show of hands, how many people have been to the Museum of Arts and Design in the room? Great, almost everybody. That's what we like to see. If you have not been, it's down on Columbus Circle. It's only three stops away on the local train. And we are, of course, the leading museum in the country for the study and display and celebration of craft, conceived broadly speaking, founded in 1956 as the Museum of Contemporary Crafts, later the American Craft Museum, and today as the Museum of Arts and Design. So I'm going to talk in the spirit of future of ways of making and knowing. I'm going to talk a little bit about where I am trying to lead the museum next. And because we are in the safe confines of the Bard Graduate Center, a place of critical and theoretical exchange, I'm going to be very open with you about some of the challenges that I foresee as I try to take this this institution in this direction. But first, the direction. What I would like to do with our institution is to see us become a new model craft museum, a place where visitors are taken behind the scenes of creative processes of all kinds and are given, if you like, a transparent view into those processes of making. And I think I'm preaching to the converted when I say that processes of making are, of course, also processes of knowing. So it's an opportunity and an attempt to share with our audience the in-depth know-how, commitment, skill, dedication that it takes to make an object of the highest quality. And if you like, an attempt to bring the audience along almost hand in hand with the maker of the object. So it's a very simple idea, really. It's almost like an X-ray machine for creativity, and it's covering the entire range of arts and design, as is said in the title of the museum. So I often like to think of the museum as a kind of conceptual T-shape, like this, very broad on the top. Any sort of design or artwork at all is fair game for us. It's all relevant in our eyes, all equally relevant in our eyes. So painting, furniture, ceramics, glass, architecture, fashion, mannequin design, subject of an exhibition that's about to open next month at the museum, literally anything could be seen through this lens, through this perspective that I'm trying to describe. The other part of the T is, of course, the depth. And the depth is that encounter with making, the encounter with not just any form of creativity, but masterful creativity, skill of the highest order. And with this T shape, I hope that we can successfully individuate ourselves as a museum, offer something unique to the visitor, something that's very accessible, something that's very approachable. As most of you as can readily imagine and perhaps have experienced yourself, this kind of behind-the-scenes active encounter with process is extremely low. It's an extremely low barrier to entry and involvement and interest on the part of the audience. So we think of ourselves as ultra accessible, ultra transparent, and entirely focused around the processes of making. Sounds good, right? You're all excited with me? Sounds like a good museum to visit, right? However, there are some problems. And I don't usually talk about the problems back at the ranch, because I'm trying to keep a positive attitude. But I will share with you some, not doubts that I have, because I do think that this is the right way forward for us, but some concerns and some challenges that I think lie ahead. And I'm going to talk about those under three broad headings. The first is interactivity. The second is clarity. And the third is quality. Those are the three ideas that I want to share with you. So first, interactivity. This in a way is the simplest problem, but it's a very difficult one to solve through curatorial methodology. Put simply, the best way to learn about making something is to make something, right? And when you're dealing with 100,000, 150,000 visitors a year, that's a tall order. So it's very difficult, in fact, to use a museum as a vehicle for teaching about making, because as we have all been talking about and thinking about this evening, much of the knowledge that is bound up with making processes is tacit, and much of it is intuitive, it is embodied. And some of the things that Florence was just describing, Ned was just describing, that are happening at Yale are exactly the kinds of things that I would like to give every visitor to the museum the opportunity to do. However, that's generally speaking not possible. We are fortunate in having on the sixth floor of MAD an open studio where visitors can meet and talk to a maker of some kind at all hours of the day. So this is a program that runs through the entire open period of the museum, 6 days a week. And that obviously is a very important anchor for us. It means that no matter what, at least at some time during their visit, every audience member will have the opportunity to see making happening in process. We also run, of course, many educational events that do involve making, and it could be making a hat, could be making a pot. We even, in many cases, offer particularly school children from New York, their very first opportunity to make something out of a raw material. Let's say a six-year-old's first opportunity to make something out of clay or out of straw, which is quite an amazing thing to be able to give somebody if you think about it. So that's a very deep part of our mission, but it's extremely difficult to bind that into an exhibition experience for all the reasons that you can imagine, ranging from the simple logistics to issues of health and safety and insurance. That leads me to the second problem, which is that of clarity. And what I'm particularly worried about here is actually false clarity, a false sense of insight, which is in fact more misleading than it is revealing. As I've said, what I'm after here is a museum that's about transparency, is a kind of x-ray machine for creative process. But what if you give somebody the impression that it's easy to do something? Turning wood on a lathe, what could be simpler? What could be more fun? When you actually put the chisel in your hands, however, and you have that chunk of mahogany whirling around, it's a different story, as you know. And I think that in some ways, the danger here is related to what in some contexts is actually a very good thing for the museum, which is the current enthusiasm for making that you see out there in the media landscape. And I'm thinking here of the many companies that are starting to advertise themselves as handmade this, artisanal that, homemade this, and are trying to draw the current enthusiasm and positive energy that people have for making into a kind of branding strategy. And the ultimate example of this that I've seen recently was a banner that I saw downtown on a building that was advertising homemade condominiums, which I think is absolutely a bellwether of our times. And certainly I do not want to lash the museum to that mast. I do not want our museum to be giving people a false positive sense of having encountered something true, because that would be to fall into the worst kinds of craft-based narratives around authenticity that that all of us would want to distance ourselves from. So it's not simply that interactivity is not always available, but also that a shallow or superficial encounter with making can in some ways be worse than a more standard museum format, because it can disguise as much as it reveals. The third problem, which is again related to the one that I just described, is that of quality. And here I think we enter into a much broader debate around what museums are for in the 21st century, and a debate that's carried forward certainly in the contemporary art arena as much as in studies of historic material culture. And that is the question, what is a high quality object and who gets to decide? And shouldn't we be thinking a lot more about who gets to decide and a lot less about trying to create a hierarchy of objects? I've said a couple of times that I'm very interested in skill, very interested in the highest levels of creative process. But here I will recall a wonderful line of the theorist David Pye, the great theorist of craft and design, who noted that from time to time in the course of history, the highest levels of workmanship have no doubt been practiced by people of the utmost depravity. And there's a real point there that actually ethical insight and the integrity of a contribution, creative contribution, does not neatly map onto what we would consider to be a set of values that we would want to subscribe to. And here I would just cite the very well-known cases of totalitarian regimes in the middle of the 20th century that latched onto crafts, just as contemporary corporations do, although perhaps that's a coincidence, latched onto crafts as a way of advancing their own nefarious political schemes. Think of the Japanese imperial government and its use of Mingay folk craft, for example, or the very deep levels of respect that the Nazi and fascist governments of Germany and Italy had for the crafts traditions of their own countries. So simply celebrating craft in and of itself is dangerous. And furthermore, if you substitute some of the now very rigorously critiqued hierarchies of artistic value with, based on, for example, gender, narratives about post-colonialism, ethnic stereotyping, that sort of thing, those kind of critical perspectives, if you say, well, we're no longer going to hold Michelangelo up here and Picasso up here and African art down here, but we are now going to replace that set of hierarchies with one based on skill and quality of execution, we, again, in a way, exchange one problem for arguably an even worse one, one with even less critical apparatus, one with even less self-reflective capability. So that is where the conversation about quality ultimately leads. It's I think it's true to say that although we at MAD are motivated by what I might even call an ideology of transparency and integrity, and I won't say authenticity, because I think we all know that these are relative values, but I will say that we are motivated by a sense that we want to tell the truth about the way the world around us is made and who is doing it, we can easily fall into these various traps along the way. So what is the solution to these problems? Well, obviously there is no one solution, and perhaps like any meeting, we should admit to ourselves that talking about the problem is the first step on the way to solving it. But I will just leave you with one thought, which is to go right back to the phrase from which we began this evening, which is ways of making and knowing. Notice the plural, ways of making and knowing. So the first thing is to say that there is no one right way of making and knowing, that ultimately a museum like ourselves or a historian conducting a study of making must attend to the individual specific case that they are studying and think about that contextually. So focusing on skill and focusing on processes of making and creativity does not absolve you of using all of the other critical apparatus of historical method and museology. You must think of these skills as being deployed in a specific historical and hopefully critical context. And that idea of multiplicity, ways of making and knowing, to me, bespeaks a kind of lateral, democratic, anti-hierarchical position that any 21st century museum would do well to think about. So that's the first thing. And the second is the latter half of the phrase, making and knowing together in combination. And here I think the phrase that I often use is very apt, which is that I always think of craft as a verb and not a noun. Craft as an action and not as a result. So you might say it's the arrow in flight, not the arrow once it's already found its target. So for me, the great advantage of focusing on making as a process, as something that's active, that can be embraced as an ongoing affair, is that it does have that openness. And many of the problems that I've described, again, cautiously approached, can be perhaps not solved, but certainly moderated and challenged by really thinking about the open-endedness of that, not being satisfied that one has ever found an answer to how one displays making in a gallery, not to say this is the best person and you must all aspire to this master, but rather to say here is a person who has a fascinating process that we can learn from and study and that might go anywhere, and to hold that door open rather than slam it shut and say that we have the answer. So that's what I have to say for you with you this evening. And in that spirit, I look forward to open conversation. Thanks again.
Thank you so much to our speakers. And we now will turn to two very fine scholars and friends who have done a great deal of thinking about these matters. Our first will be Lisa O'Sullivan, who's the director of the Center for the History of Medicine and Public Health at the New York Academy of Medicine. Lisa most recently served as senior curator of medicine at the Science Museum London, where she curated the Wellcome Collection, one I think you all know. And she was head of research for the Wellcome Trust-funded Brought to Life website, highlighting the global reach of the Wellcome and Science Museum's medical collection. I'm responsible for issues relating to human remains and culturally sensitive materials in the collection. She led the Science Museum's repatriation work. Lisa will be followed by Martina Droth, who serves as Associate Director of Research and Curator of Sculpture at the Yale Center for British Art, having begun her career as Head of Research at the Henry Moore Institute in Leeds. Martina works on sculpture, in particular British sculpture of the 19th and 20th centuries. She is interested in materials and practice and sculpture's relationship with craft and decorative arts. She has published and worked on a wide range of curatorial projects, most recently the exhibition Sculpture Victorious, Art in an Age of Invention, 1837 to 1901, which just closed at the Yale Center for British Art and will open at Tate Britain later this month. We'll begin with Lisa.
First of all, thank you very much indeed for having me. This has just been a fantastic set of discussions and thoughts, to the point where I'm not sure I can read my own writing because I took a lot of notes. I'm going to be a little bit anecdotal. I hope you'll forgive me. That's because a lot of the reactions I had was flashbacks to certain moments as a working curator, and particularly creating the Wellcome Collection. Yes, many of you will all know the Wellcome Collection. As a very top-level recap, Henry Wellcome, the American term to British pharmaceutical giant, collected over 1 million objects in his lifetime. And he had a very, very particular intellectual agenda. One of the fascinating things for me about curating that collection, even at the reduced 100,000 objects which were worthy of being kept by the Science Museum as the core, this has got something to do with medicine as we now understand it, collection, was completely bonkers. So, of course, I scuttled immediately into the ex-votos and the amulets and the rooms of crazy anthropological materials that somehow found their way in. What that made me think about a lot was the meanings attributed to the objects by the makers, the meanings attributed to them by the collectors, and how that changes over time. Many of the items that people wanted to use from the collections, they wanted to use as aesthetic objects. One of the kind of themes for me is very much this art and science continuum. What is the role of aesthetics in scientific objects? And I mean, the Blaschkas are obviously the kind of reigning gods, I think, straight from jewelers into makers of didactic specimens without losing a single aesthetic moment on the way. So that's something that kept me thinking a lot, particularly because I could tell that Henry Wellcome would have been rolling in his grave at some of the ways we were now choosing to interpret his collection. But today, this evening's program has also solved one of the niggling complaints I used to have. Because it was the Wellcome Collection and thanks to the Wellcome Trust, there's a lot of publicly available images of the collection. There were a lot of academics writing on our collection. And one of the games we used to play was to figure out if said academic had actually ever visited the stores. The answer is, unsurprisingly, very few. But then we would have these existential moments of crisis about, well, what would have changed in that paper had they visited? And 9 times out of 10, unfortunately, the answer was not very much. So then, one of the other things, curators, we talk a lot. And very little of this ever gets into the public sphere. This is our own kind of thinking and processing. But I think really the answer you've given me this evening is that the type of object histories being written that we were seeing about the collections we worked with were the very reductive ones that treated them from a very specific perspective that lost a lot of the materiality and the actual function and use of these objects. And you wanted to say, come on in, pick them up. They're a little bit too heavy to be used in, you know, really basic stuff. So that's one aspect. Tacit knowledge is fascinating to me, both in the way it becomes embodied in people's bodies, but also in the actual objects themselves. And I'd love to hear more about how you recognize tacit knowledge, how you document it, and how you archive it. I mean, I think, as multiple people have mentioned this evening, the publication of a book, while a fine technological object in itself, never, you know, books as technologies is my new mantra now that I run a library rather than work with material artifacts of a different nature. It's a very specific form of knowledge, and I think what we've seen in terms of capturing things through multimedia is fantastic, but something in me feels it hasn't gone quite far enough, that there is something else that needs, we need to keep thinking about that, particularly because we've been talking about a lot of craft, and the other thing that kept popping back into my mind was, yes, I scuttled away from the 20th century collections. I went safely back into the 19th century where you really could see the artisanal nature of many of the scientific and medical objects in the collection. But even with the 20th century material, with automated mechanized processes, most of the scientists I've ever talked to about how they used this, they start talking about the duct tape that they, you know, they start talking about what you actually had to do to this automated mechanized product to make it work for you and your particular experiment. And I would really love to see this discussion extended into all the black boxes, in fact, often grey boxes, of second half of 20th century and beyond objects, in terms of how the tacit knowledge contained in them and their use gets thought about, preserved, and so forth. I was also thinking about connoisseurial knowledge as a dirty word or not a dirty word. A lot of this is about different communities and different ways they produce and communicate knowledge. How do we make friends with the connoisseurs again? How do we actually get their forms of interpreting and understanding objects back into the narratives? I think that's, again, something I really experienced with partly in the museum, but I'll be even more so in the library, where now, for those of you who don't know it, the Academy has one of the finest collections of books relating to medicine and health in the country. And again, it's like the Wellcome Collection. It says it's medicine and health, but it is extraordinarily broad. Many of our supporters are bibliophiles. And it's astounding to me that a collector who owns half a dozen copies of an extremely important book will then ask me about, oh, how do these books get bound? Why is my book bound like this? And their knowledge, and then the next collector along can tell you everything about the bindings, but the content is completely irrelevant to them. So I think books is an interesting example of, as I said, a technological object that has a lot of potential for different interpretation. So I don't want to talk too long, but the only other thing that I kind of wanted to loop back to was the role of making in the academy. How do you assess things that are not written? And I know this is an issue that far more than I've ever had to grapple with, people in architectural and design departments, fashion departments do. But I always like thinking of it in terms of history as well. What would a accessible piece of making look like inside and outside the academy? But I think, my main kind of reaction to this is excitement, is thinking that it's a form of interdisciplinarity that I like because it recognises depth knowledge. And in fact, the best multidisciplinary connections come out of depth knowledge and recognising other people's depth knowledge and finding a common language. And I think that's what a lot of the academic production I've seen around material culture when I was curating the Wellcome Collection didn't do. So I'm delighted that there is this fantastic community who are clearly really engaged in that. Thank you.
Thank you, Amy and Pam, for the invitation. So I was asked to give a short response, and I'll do so from the perspective of thinking about sculpture. And we've just been talking about skills and practices from a very broad and open-ended range of perspectives. So maybe in some ways, to sort of funnel that into sculpture seems a little reductive. But I think that in itself is quite pertinent to address because I think it highlights some of the problems in dealing with sculpture as an art historical subject. And the very word sculpture is problematic, especially in the context of our conversation today, in that it suggests that we're talking about a discrete form of art that somehow occupies its own distinct sphere. And in many ways, that is the way in which sculpture is addressed in art history. But of course, the opposite really is true, in that sculpture is very difficult to delimit and contain, not least because the materials and processes that it are involved in making sculpture are so diffuse and diverse and shared and intersecting with so many different kinds of object production. So in some ways, it's more helpful to think of sculpture as an elastic concept that comprises a range of practices and forms part of a wider material culture, which, however, art history does not necessarily concern itself with. So sculpture can appear like a fragmented field, and I think this is often an effect of the way in which it tends to be studied. So in relation to our concern here with ways of making and knowing, I think the study of sculpture as an art historical field presents an interesting paradoxical circumstance, in that materials and modes of making are absolutely fundamental to how our definitions and our taxonomies of sculpture have become structured. Materials are very often used as organizational principles for making categories of objects. So, for example, when we see a porcelain object, we immediately bracket that into one type of art production, whereas if we think of a marble and bronze object, we might immediately conjure up the term fine art sculpture or something like that. And that also, to some extent, transfers onto modes of production and how we define sculptural practice as opposed to or related to sometimes artisanal practice or craft or industrial production. And some of those don't really enter into art historical stories so much. But even though materials and ways of making are such a fundamental part of art historical conceptions of sculpture, this has not, on the whole, translated into a compulsion within the field to really study and understand materials and knowledge in a concentrated way, or to prioritize them as a sort of essential field of inquiry that we need to deal with. And there seem to be different reasons for this, but one sort of very obvious one might be that the kind of sculpture that art history is most interested in is that which can be linked to an individual artist. And this prioritizing of the artist can, of course, work in very confluent ways with inquiries into practice and material knowledge. But the driving factor tends to reside in how we define and maintain the link between the artist and the object. And so the artist is very often the primary umbrella by which objects are organized. And this can end up, in a sense, ring-fencing objects and isolating them, even from contexts with which they may be intimately related. To give just one example, the reproduction of a sculpture by a commercial manufacturer, maybe at a different time and place. This kind of removal of the object from the purview of the artist or from the direct control and engagement of the artist can also, in many cases, herald its removal from the purview of the art historian and the subject of inquiry. And so I think the Making and Knowing project suggests many potential avenues and models for thinking about how we study objects and the kinds of information we prioritize. And this, for me, has been really the valuable lesson of this book and of this project, which I've kind of been conscious of for many years. And even though the kinds of objects I'm interested in, for example, are very different to the ones that Ned Cook or Glenn Adamson or Pam Smith might be working on, it's really through their work that I have learned much more on how to think about sculpture than I have found in many sort of standard art history textbooks on sculpture. So I just wanted to mention a few of the questions that the project made me think about. So for sculpture specifically, it's raised for me the question that we need to ask is, what is sculpture? Is it even a valid term that we can use to define a set of objects or practices? It might be time to reconsider the narrow ways in which we think about categories of art production. And I don't mean simply by widening the boundaries and permitting more objects into our purview, but really by letting go of the need for those boundaries, perhaps in the first place, and rethinking the parameters of the kinds of questions that we want to ask from objects. What are the contexts that we grant to our objects of study? In the book, we have case studies of sculptures that appear amidst a range of many other different kinds of case studies about plants and cabinets. And I think this in itself presents a very different kind of history for sculpture than one will find in art history books. The Making and Knowing project doesn't just ask who made the objects, but about how objects function in a culture. And I think this can lead us in very different directions for sculpture. And I think it points to a need for much deeper engagement with materials and process. And just to give a sort of concrete example from my own experience, the exhibition that Amy mentioned, which opens at Tate Britain Sculpture Victoria's Art in an Age of Invention, the starting point was really to think about what roles were given to sculpture, why was it invested in so greatly, rather than starting with a set of artists that we wanted to explore. We wanted to explore what was it that made sculpture so important. And we found that this was very intimately bound up with the ways in which sculpture was made, with invention and with technology. And a key area of investigation is reproduction, the different forms this takes, and the role of different processes that were pioneered with the express aim of facilitating reproduction. And so in our exhibition, we included a plaster cast of a medieval tomb, an electrotype cast of another, which were made for important public displays in the period. And these are objects that can tell us such a lot about the roles that was played by sculpture in the period, but they appear in no art history books on sculpture. One of the aspects that has come across most strongly to me from this project and from the discussions today is that our modes of inquiry need to become much more open and inclusive, and that collaboration is really a key element to enabling this because of the many different kinds of information that we need to amass, the kinds of experiences of learning that we need, even the collection of data sets and taking account of many different kinds of evidence and how we then process that, which doesn't necessarily lend itself to a sort of solitary scholarship, but lends itself much more to a collaborative and more open-ended scholarship. I think that's really all I had to say, and I think the rest of the time is for questions, so thank you.
Okay, now it's your turn. I would like all of the panelists to come up here and sit, and maybe Amy, you can join them. I think there's room, yeah. Or maybe bring up a chair, yeah. Yeah, I'll just stay here and moderate, yeah, yeah. Okay, so I will start.
I get to be Harold Cook and that.
We brought you two hats.
I know. Yeah.
Well, first I'd like to very deeply...
I'm here.
Hi, Hal. I don't like that feedback. I'd first like to very deeply thank all of the participants in this, all of the panelists and the respondents, and now I would like to open the floor to questions. Yes?
I have a question. I think I could start us off at kind of a superficial level, so maybe that's good.
If you could use the
microphone. Sorry, and with a microphone at a superficial level. So my question, I think, touches on something. Maybe it's something that Ned and Glenn, and I think also Florence, each touched on. And that is, I think maybe I'll start with, I liked Glenn's idea of the sort of false sense of transparency. I was thinking sort of a little knowledge is a dangerous thing, maybe. And I'm wondering about this sense of how that works also in, you know, academic pedagogical situations, not just in museum pedagogy. I'm somebody who came from an undergraduate background of doing art history and doing studio at the same time, and doing much better in history than in studio, but continuing to do studio at the same time, and coming to graduate school feeling like I knew something about making processes, and being surprised when I started reading texts by historians who didn't know things about making processes, and it was very obvious to me. And I think I, especially because I came to graduate school here at the BGC, and I was sort of thrilled to be in this atmosphere of, you know, craft and design history, and this was something new to me, I thought just intuitively, everyone writing about this will know all about the process of making these objects, and that wasn't necessarily the case. And so I guess what I'm curious about is not just, I think Ned brought up the question of having the space to sort of implement some programs that will take us in a different direction. My concern would also be time, right? That some of the sense of kind of being able to get your hands on some of these materials, about being able to sort of start learning some of these processes, but anybody who works with any material, I think, knows very well the sensation that you know the material much better in a month than you did when you started, and you know the material much better in a year, and you know the material much better in 10 years. And that's certainly reflected, I think, you know, in what, Glenn, you were talking about in terms of this high level of craft that's really this, you know, sort of consummate level of skill that's acquired over time. And we talk about craft practice, so we have this sense of that it's cumulative knowledge, right? So I'm wondering how this can be implemented in terms of, you know, university pedagogy, how it works maybe for undergraduates, but also for graduate students who may really, for whom a little knowledge might be a dangerous thing, like, oh, I did this for a week or I did this for a day and now I know how to do X. And maybe that's not true. And I'm wondering if that's something that you've thought about or how that would work into your project specifically.
Very much so. I mean, people are not, I always joke about not quitting my day job. I don't have any kind of... any kind of sense of that I am a qualified maker, I'm a tinkerer. And I think that what I view it as is sort of at least exposure. So what's surprising, I mean, you talked about sort of your dismay about reading things that obviously these people had never had handled. And a lot of it is based on people writing on pictures of objects rather than the real thing. And I've seen that time and time again with exhibitions, that you're writing on a picture and what somebody told you about it. So how can you at least raise consciousness, I guess, is what I always try to think of with a graduate student. What can you build in a good habit of material curiosity? Can you give them a set of experiences and an apparatus to open it up, as I said, rather than narrowing down, to put it in that nice little typology? Mm-hmm. And You say, sort of, how can you do that for graduate students? Well, it's kind of interesting how in a lot of graduate programs we have continued to say you've got to have two languages, right? So, you know, you've got to have German and French or whatever that you have done, because that's necessary for the kind of research you're doing. But that's assuming archival research, that's assuming periodical research. Can we actually introduce even something small that actually starts to get at sort of how can you open up questions in using a material archive?
I think I can speak to this also from our laboratory seminars, which run for a semester, and time is a huge, huge problem. And being able to integrate both reading of works, theoretical works and methodological works, and discussing them, and also doing the hands-on work, which, you know, the class itself is 4 hours, and they're expected to work in the lab almost every week for more hours, and we have a visiting maker who comes in and really starts us going, and then they're in the lab a lot. You know, there's a model for this. It's called science and scientific research, and it takes a lot of time in the lab, and we find that that's... you know, we find ourselves acting in those ways, in those collaborative ways, in those ways of, you know, setting up the materials. And so we can learn a lot, actually, by looking at the way that these things were institutionalized. I mean, these modes of investigation, materials, research were institutionalized in the early 19th century.
Can I just add briefly that it's even worse than we think? Because in addition to the first order problem of assuming that you know a process enough to speak about it competently, there's the second order problem of assuming that you know what process involves in general enough to speak about it with a kind of critical apparatus that's adequate. And my favorite example of this is like an unfavorite example, is Richard Sennett's famous thing about it takes 10,000 hours to master a craft. And if you just think about that for even 1 second, you'll realize that it can't possibly make sense. Because if it takes 10,000 hours to master planning a board, to use Ned's example, could it also then take 10,000 hours to learn how to make a whole cabinet? Well, that doesn't work out, does it? And obviously he's making a simple point, which is that it takes a lot of time, which I think we can all agree on, and, you know, apprentices work for 7 years before becoming journeymen for a reason. But there is, I think, a great tendency among those of us who talk and write and read for a living to assume that we've got it now, and now we can speak confidently for these mute craftspeople of the past or present. So I would totally agree with both Ned and Pamela. And, you know, you talked about material curiosity, which I think is a great way of putting it. But allied to this would have to be a kind of material humility, which maybe
well,
we could learn from science.
Well, but, you know, that's one thing I was going to say in response to where is the critical assessment going to come from? The materials tell you. Actually, I mean, I would say that this material work, working with the materials, is a much more humbling experience, and that none of the students went away feeling like they were experts in any way. Yeah. I mean, they understood they had gotten exposure, and they had new avenues which they could... you know, enter into in their dissertation research, but none of them felt proud of
peer
their products.
Yeah.
You know, proud of the experience. I mean, it's about process, exactly as you said. It's about verbs. It's not about nouns. Yes, back there.
I hope this comes out as a question. This was such an interesting talk, and it had me thinking about an experience that I had when I taught at Parsons. And my job was to teach designers or aspiring designers how to read, write, and think critically, especially around issues of design. And it's interesting that we're sort of talking about the mere image of these people. So we expect designers who are going to a university to have some skills about thinking through design issues and reading and writing about them. And I'm just, it occurred to me, especially since we're celebrating the Socratic idea of knowing what you don't know, and that being a good pedagogical practice, and also thinking about the idea of collaboration, I wonder if there's some way that we could have these two groups collaborate in some way. I wonder, instead of learning from a master craftsman, maybe it would be valuable and engaging to learn from someone who is learning design practices. And maybe there's some kind of way that these two groups could actually learn from each other. That's all I have to say. I hope that's, you know, by way of a question. So
two things just off the bat. The first one is that, as Ned was saying earlier, design and practice are absolutely part of the same ways of thinking, and so I think bringing designers into a conversation like this would be fantastic. And also I think what you're proposing is great, because the more projects like this are useful to everyone who participates in them, you know, if there is, if our skills of reading and writing aren't just used by us when we leave the workshop, but could also contribute to a wider exchange of skill, I think that would be fantastic.
I think the notion of people who are learning teaching people who are learning within a university context particularly is so important. And the kind of pedagogical experiences that Pamela and Ned and Florence are crafting, of course, implicitly involve that, because you're going to have students coming from a variety of vantage points and experiential levels with who come into these environments. And I can't imagine but that in Pamela's course, for example, where there are science students, there are design students, there are historians of science, there are art historians.
Literature students, architecture students.
That
anthropologists.
The interdisciplinary nature of the practice itself that you are engaged in is going to be multiplied in manifold ways by the actual participants in the process. And I think that that should be, and naturally should be, part of the teaching process. And it would be very, almost impossible to imagine it otherwise, actually. But one thing that we might remember is that this is such a rare and unusual proposition within the humanities. And I think, as Pamela points out, science is such, the laboratory is such an important model for humanistic pursuits in this way, and science students within the context of the humanists classroom, I think, are very important, because they're also learning in very different ways. And so, you know, insisting on that kind of multiplicity of background in one's classroom, I think, would be quite critical.
Right here first, and then right behind you, and
me.
Then, yes, you, yes,
me.
You, yes.
Hi, sort of following up on the conversation right now, I'm wondering if you have, or you are in the process of, or will, or plan to engage with sort of art history of the deep past. I come from the, a few of us here come from the ancient Near East, and we have the problem, of course, of having no living artisans, and the texts are all ancient texts for which we have no living translators. So one of our problems is that we do have an abundance of such textual information on crafting from Sumerian sources, Akkadian sources, but of course the Sumerologists who are translating these texts and these words for specific technologies have never picked up a tool or a material that is related. And, you know, I have worked on this a little bit, and I can tell you from a little bit, just a tiny bit of goldsmithing background, nowhere near a master class of any sort, you know, there's already a disconnect between how these terms for crafting have been passed down since Sumerology has existed. So it's another sort of side field and associated problem that would come into this mix.
Well, certainly there are realms of objects and making practices associated with them which have undergone a lot of historical research. I'm thinking of shipbuilding, for example, you know, trireme making and things like that, in which there are some objects or some remains of objects. There are also some texts, and that it seems to be a similar or an analogous case in which people, and especially their largely enthusiasts, I think, who are remaking those kinds of ancient texts.
Or the experimental archaeologists who are
exactly.
trying to do that. But you know, to me, one of the real issues is translation, is
yeah.
words,
yeah.
And what words mean. That oftentimes, if you think about even terms that we encounter in terms of everyday practice of modern technology and how, you know, if you go through the OED, then actually has a very different kind of etymology to it.
Mm-hmm.
The meanings are constantly changing. If you even think about the word craft, mm-hmm. I mean, it's as simple as that. And see how that's used at different times. And can you imagine somebody a couple of hundred years from now trying to translate some of these terms mm-hmm. and put it into a different sort of a language system, a different kind of context?
Mm-hmm.
So I take your point in terms of, you know, even collaboration. Can you push somebody who deals with the actual, you know, language of the time period? Are they going to be sufficient to help you get the nuance of mm-hmm. what it means in that particular moment?
And that's where crafting, yeah. doing it yourself, actually helps.
Could
even
be.
In the
Could.
Most minimal,
yeah.
you know, month-long format.
Yeah.
Yeah, just exposure.
Dan.
This is kind of an oddball question. I hope you won't think I'm trying to divert the conversation in into a completely different direction. Think of it as inviting you to take a road stop and have a look at a different vista. And then proceed on your way. I asked the question, though, because of the assembled expertise and diversity of expertise in the room. And the question is this. What do you all think of applying this framework of making and knowing as a means of analysis, historical understanding, pedagogy, and so on, to the living world, as distinct from the world of physical craft, if you will? So if you consider plants and animals, they have to be bred, they're nourished, they're grown for a whole variety of different purposes. These include, obviously, nourishment, materials, aesthetic enjoyment, conservation purposes, landscape, interior design, if you think about flowers and so on and on and on. And anybody who's ever been in a garden, at least with a green thumb, doesn't have a green thumb, knows that it's no trivial matter just to take a grower's guide and plant the seed and expect to get a beautiful crop. So you can see, I think I'd like to suggest that there is a parallel in the living world of plants and animals, and some of you have thought about this, for example, Amy, I know, and maybe there's even an essay in that book, if I remember correctly, on Bartram, et cetera. I haven't seen the whole book, but I did know about that essay. What you would think about trying to do this, you've got enough on your plate. I'm not asking you to do this. But what do you think about trying to do this, applying it to the world of plants and animals and also in a hands-on making and knowing sense?
That's exactly what they were doing at Paynes Hill Park, where we ended the conference. And there's an essay by the gardener at Paynes Hill, one of the gardeners at Paynes Hill, who did the historical the project both on transporting, because Paynes Hill Park is one of the first American gardens in the UK. So that means that it obviously did all of that cultivation, and the plants did it too. You know, the plants had agency in the in adapting also to the environment in which they were being acclimatized. But so they're doing it there in terms of trying to figure out which species were brought in and how they've developed since then, and as well as trying to figure out what are the historical methods of cultivation and transportation. And certainly any 16th century book of recipes, collection of recipes in the way that our manuscript is a collection of recipes, contains recipes for grafting and all kinds of recipes for growing fruit trees especially.
this gets very complicated, and Dan knows this perfectly well because he's working on the most extraordinary project, which has to do with the history of hybridization and depictions of hybridized things. And Pamela points to Painsell, and of course Mark Laird, who's at Harvard, has been working with Teresa and with me and with a whole group of scholars in terms of the understanding this issue of the shaping of natural things to human concerns. And it gets very complicated, and it becomes science because you end up with, you're dealing with modern genetically modified things, and you have to understand how they got to be the way they are, and the roadmap back is very difficult. And it becomes a genetics problem. And so it's quite, you know, with Mark's work, let's say on flocks, taking flocks back to its original natural source is very difficult because it really...
Well, I was thinking more historically, I was thinking more historically, not trying to trace back, but after all, people were engaged before the 20th century, before the rediscovery of Mendel, in trying to shape the natural world.
Oh yes, Dan, I agree. End,
right, so what I have in mind is the what Pamela is doing, for example, in craft work, and the work of the artisan, is what about the work of the breeder? Say in 1800 or 1850 or whatever, who's trying to find a plant and then acclimate it, appropriate it, develop it, and so on, for a particular purpose, and to bring students into that world, right? Rather than try to work back, I don't care about working back myself, but to expose, this is a way of doing historical scholarship. That seems to me to be a parallel to what this project is about.
I completely agree with you. You can work in either direction. My simple point was that it depends on what you're doing. If you want to start with the original thing and see how it got hybridized, you have a problem with the original thing. And so it does get quite complicated. The process of hybridization, of course, and that's a fantastic laboratory process for students to go through. But if you're doing historical research and you want to understand how something got from its natural form to what you see at a certain point in an illustration from 1850, you've got a very complicated problem to work through that's fascinating, challenging, but quite challenging to figure out how to deal with.
Lisa wants to say something.
I think absolutely. One of the issues is exactly how tacit some of this knowledge was, and that there was there were hierarchies of knowledge, of course, within science and technology. So what you're talking about is much more the craft side of the gardeners, not the lady of the house writing about
all the people Darwin wrote to
the pigeon fanciers. How you reconstruct that tacit knowledge is a fascinating question, because when you look at, say, a set of, I mean, I don't want to open up a complete can of worms, but, you know, this getting back to what the natural form is an endless rabbit hole. So that you can look, I mean, one of the take-home messages for me is that the whole concepts of process and making and knowing have not disappeared in the sciences or been sidelined within academic science in the way they have in the humanities, right? Mm-hmm. So, but I think what Dan points to very correctly is within the sciences there is that science-technology divide that has become reified, so that, I don't know how you unpack the unnaturalness of the natural world. I think it's a really, really interesting project, but needs a lot of speculation.
Another question, back there.
I really appreciate these projects a lot because I'm working on a dissertation that's about unmaking of objects, and it is concerned with similar practices. But I guess I wanted to maybe play devil's advocate and ask, is there a danger in making the moment of creation, to put such focus on the moment of creation, and does that shut down some types of interpretations? I'm thinking about the ways that objects exist through time, and they have different meanings over time, and some of those ideas about objects cannot be kept connected to the moment of making, and they're still valid and interesting for us to pursue, and the interpretations that art historians might make where they haven't visited the collections, maybe, they might also be valid and interesting.
It doesn't mean that one's mutually exclusive from the other. I mean, there's been enough work on the social life of things, obviously, yes. To use the a phrase of commonality, but you know, what I get interested is, you know, Ali, is sort of the notions of maintenance, about repair, about adaptation, and actually the role of tacit knowledge or not having tacit knowledge actually comes to play on many of those things. So you need the same set of skills. It, you know, I think that you have a cautionary sort of thing saying we should not privilege the moment, that pure moment of creation, literally as it came out of the shop, literally into the air before it, you know, started its downward plummet through life, right? But it's trying to get sort of that notion about fabrication, I guess, and how fabrication actually has meaning over time as well. So you're correct.
Yeah,
just to connect to this remark and the earlier remark about the notion of connecting learning historians to learning designers. Or one group we didn't mention yet where we do that actually is our just started tentative collaboration with computer science students, where they learning to program or envision like future digital editions where we try to craft with them our future edition, and that way also you could say like our going in the lab, going back to the moment of creation of those writings, we are more or less like redoing in the 21st century in a collaborative effort this workshop of writing a digital edition with our technological means today, and how to, you know, how to work in our workshop on that, and think about, reflect about the writing practices of the past and the future. So it's a double movement, actually, I would say. So reconstruction is not only directed to the past, but also to the future.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes, back there. Yes, there,
okay. This is a question for Glenn. I'm just thinking about contemporary artists who are very committed to making, and sometimes even working in traditional craft media, but are resistant to talking about it because they identify with the contemporary art audience where that's very much passé. And like, is there any place for them within your new model of the museum? Because much of their work is quite fascinating, and it's a, you know, I think an important trend, but it's hard to see how you can get them to open up to these questions of quality or skill.
Yeah, so first of all, just to identify the questioner, that's Elisa Author, who's recently joined the museum, and Bard. this is actually a very exciting initiative. So with the support of the Wingate Charitable Foundation, we've been able to hire Elisa to curate at the museum and also lead the scholarly activities at the museum, and then to teach and supervise students here at Bard. So welcome, Elisa, and thanks for the question. So this is something I have given a lot of thought to, and there, it doesn't really admit of a simple answer, so I'm just going to give you one example, which is the case of the fine art fabricator, which is a particularly interesting figure in contemporary art. Mm-hmm. And you could say, if you wanted to be bold about it and maybe even exaggerate a bit, that in the future, 50 years hence, for example, you might well find that art historians are much more interested in the productive bedrock of contemporary art than they are interested in what contemporary artists say at the moment that they're interested in. Because if you look at it from a bird's eye perspective, the kind of gobsmacking, astounding thing about contemporary art is that it's big, expensive, made of luxury materials, or very difficult to work in materials like stainless steel, and it is
absolutely extraordinary in its production values. It's much more like Hollywood film in some ways than it is like art of the mid-century period. Mm. And most of the discourse around contemporary art, of course, deflects from that. So taking an obvious figure like Jeff Koons, the discussion tends to be about his mobilization of kitsch imagery, for example, whereas the obvious thing that you want to know about Jeff Koons is, how did that get made? Who made it? What's going on on a production scenario basis? And in fact, as I've argued, Jeff Koons turns out to be much, much more interesting over the course of his career in his shifts in production than his shifts in content, which I would argue is one of the reasons he's become such an emblematic figure, for better or worse, of our times. So, returning to the museum, I think that we have not only an opportunity, but also in some ways an obligation to apply the same X-ray machine logic that I was describing to contemporary art and its presumption that an artist who wants to get something done will just go ahead and do it and never mind how. Whereas I want to really reverse that and say, actually, the how is probably the area where criticality is most lacking and most needed.
So we look forward to a slim and intellectual volume on fabrication from the Museum of Art and Design. One more question. I think we have time for one more question. Yeah.
This follows directly from that question and the previous one about computers. Because one of the things, just following on from the terms that Ned had given us about imagining material literacy, and I think where you were starting to go with was saying that in the way that we expect our students to have two languages, you didn't quite say this, but you were almost paraphrasing Kittler in the line about the qualifications for a modern intellectual or a contemporary intellectual being something like competence in a language and in a computer language. And it strikes me so palpably, just following on from this last point, how massively the technologies of coding are to the art that most of our students want to study. Mm-hmm. And that, as I know, having recently been involved for my sins in trying to do a website, that's total craft. It is super... super craft. And I'm just wondering, why is that not, why is the infrastructure of the environment that we live in now, is that potentially part of your scheme? It seems so essential.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's one of those options, because certainly programming language gets you into a whole other series of productive possibilities, whether, you know, some of what I was talking about is a older kind of shop tradition. Yes, it's got a historical dimension that has a present day kind of visibility, but it is sort of true that one would have to also understand the connection between programming language and, you know, the idea of bot box printers and sort of the way fabrication shops run now, driven, any media lab you go into are driven from the programming language to the actual process to the finished product. So to me, you know, and there's not a connect the way people used to say, oh, if you learn hand skills then you'll understand the applications of machinery. It's a totally different world. And to me, that would be sort of like, do you have German or do you have French? You know, it's yet another language, in essence, to master its use. Or not master, but at least get some exposure to it to ask the right questions.
But, I mean, to just sort of extend on to the point of undoing these kinds of stories that we hear about dematerialization, blah, 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 and following, just as Glenn suggested, the tracks that would connect us back from coding interfaces and programming to the server farms, to the larger technological apparatus that enables these kinds of fantasies of production that we may have, I think that would be a super important contribution to a kind of critical history of know-how in the present that implicates our understanding of these
making techniques. And interestingly enough, that computer science programs are not doing either. Mm-hmm. Right? I mean, it's not as if
we are blind in terms of what we're doing, but it's something that even people in that field are not necessarily writing about in the same way. Just in the same way contemporary art is not making those linkages back.
Pamela, well, I think you need to do a sequel.
Yes, well, I was going to say that is the future of making and knowing.
Yeah.
But I think that it's interesting to reflect on it, what seems to be the fact that most of the makers spaces that are popping up at Yale and at Columbia in the engineering schools are, in fact, maker spaces for coders who are coding the 3D printers and the laser cutters. And so there, I think you see the intersection, and it's interesting that they're called maker spaces. So with that, I think we have to say, well, we have seen a little bit of a glimpse of the future in making and knowing, but it's wonderful that you are all here, and thank you for these wonderful questions and reflections. And now I'm going to turn over the closing to Peter Miller.
two brief points before I bid you out into the before the cold, into the reception outside. The first is back to Ali's point that ways of making and knowing through the lens of time is called conservation. And so that's my cue just to let you know that in Bard Graduate Center's Cultures of Conservation initiative funded by the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, in this season, in this semester, we have three events. On February 25th, the conversation on the conservation of indigenous objects. On the 31st of March, a conversation on the conservation of the future. On March 20th, an all-day symposium on extreme conservation. That's conservation of extreme things, so objects from outer space, concentration camps, animals, etc. And on March 3rd, we have a conversation between a scholar and a conservator and maker who are already in conversation, working together, modeling the future. And that's actually going to be Pamela herself with Andrew Lacey on March 3rd right here. The second point is just to step back a little bit. Since we are in an institution for graduate training and thinking about innovative ways of training the future scholars in the humanities, it's important to recognize that we are ourselves modeling a way of making and knowing. We've had people here speaking from the podium, we've had people talking from the table, we've had people from other places, sorry Hal that you couldn't be with us, and we have people talking from different disciplinary and institutional perspectives. And if we are to tackle the kinds of problems that don't fit neatly in disciplines built really on medieval foundations, but to think about conversations that address issues in the world is not packaged in terms of discipline, then it's evenings like this and the reformation of packages of knowledge to tackle these kinds of problems that is really the task for our future. So I want to thank the editors and organizers of this volume for the effort into the book, and for the effort at organizing this, and for the panelists who graciously agreed to come here, and to all of you who've been part of what I think has been a riveting evening. So I thank all of you and all of you very much.